let me say that, sir. He could have amended the constitution, but you chose not to, and you relinquished power. So you set a kind of a benchmark for the whole of Africa to do that.
Because our constitution was like that. The constitution, that's what Patentante of the Constitution of the Republic of America. I just followed the constitution.
I think you're extremely humble, sir. By giving the, and after all, it was under your leadership that that constitution was brought about.
Yes, the constitution, of course, was brought about by the negotiations of the people of Namibia under the leadership of Suhar, and that gives each leader to stay in the office for such and such time, and they allow the other leaders to continue. But I remain still a member of the party.
In hindsight, now as you see the entire decolonization process in Africa, do you think it succeeded in building a new world based on justice and equity? Of course, that is always a work in progress, but and society is dynamic. But do you think Africa has moved forward to creating a new society?
Yes, indeed, of course. Colonialism was wiped out from the face of the African continent, and that we enjoy freedom, and we join with the rest of the international community, we become members of the movement of the Atlantic countries, and the members of the United Nations organization. So together we've been able to build our country economically and join the rest of the continent of Africa and the rest of the world through the movement of the non-aligned countries and of course the United Nations organization.
Your Excellency, your present visit comes just after the third India-Africa Forum Summit, which just took place a few weeks ago, where 54 heads of government were with us in New Delhi. How do you feel the India-Africa relation can be further strengthened and deepened in the short run, and how it can shape up in the long run?
I think right from the early days, for the struggle for the people of Africa and Asia, this we should continue building up a stronger economy with a clear purpose of wiping out poverty, disease, and ignorance from the face of, the, of our continents. So, in order to ensure the maintenance of world peace and security all over the world.
We in India, sir, are of course very impressed by the African Union's Agenda 2063. The choice of 2063 is most appropriate for the 50 years of the establishment of AU. We note with appreciation your global strategy to optimize use of Africa's resources for the benefit of all Africans. The fact that the world's resources are not being used to benefit all in an equitable way is of concern to all of us. The human resource, the human race has the knowledge, the technology, and the resources to wipe out hunger. Yet millions go hungry to bed every night. How do you think Africa and India can show the way forward?
Yes, I think through unity of purpose and action, and ensuring the education to all our citizens, we will be able to utilize the technological know-how and maintain peace and stability throughout the world, and also through the movement of the non-aligned countries, the city, happening during our struggle for freedom and independence.
So we meet in the shadow of the Paris terrorist attack. Now, India and Africa share diversity, pluralism. To us, you are a rainbow continent, and to you, we are, to use an African phrase, a rainbow country. Do you think India and Africa can tackle terrorism together?
Yes, we must unite with the clear purpose of ensuring that there is no repetition of such kind of barbaric attack where human beings were killed in terms of, in a state of certainness about this attack in Paris. They must be condemned and rejected.
Coming to a lighter side, sir, this is, I believe, your 12th visit to India. And I mean, you've spent about a day plus on this visit already. Now, what do you feel about our country now today as we move towards a greater role in international affairs?
Well, I'm very much impressed by the economic development of India and political and diplomatic support of aiming at ensuring the maintenance of world peace and security.
Thank you. Thank you. Now, I probably will pick up a few questions, sir, for the audience, with your permission. Pastor Fabian? Can we have the... What is this?
Your Excellency, it was so heartwarming to listen to you. I wanted to ask you a question about how you see Australia's future in the next 5 to 10 years? Because we see the prospects for economic progress, we see the prospect for political sort of move towards unity or union. You have the African Union, you don't have the Asian Union, for example. So how do you see the immediate future?
Master wants to know how you see the progress of Africa in the next few years.
Well, certainly Africa will continue to progress with the economic development, with the clear purpose of ensuring peace in Africa, because where there is no peace, there can be no development. Peace and stability are the key to economic development and the eradication of poverty, disease, and the ignorance among the African people, as well as joining the rest of the international community to ensuring that peace instability are maintained and people continue with the economic development.
He also mentioned that you have an African Union and we don't have an Asian Union yet, so we have a lot to learn from you.
No, we did, but we can revive the movement of the other countries.
Yeah.
Yeah. The establishment is already there. That can be easily be revived because the member states are there.
Can we pick up this? Yes, Vijay Nair.